Good morning, dear students. Today we will discuss about the vitamin A, that is its chemistry, its function and deficiency. So we all know that vitamin A is a fat soluble vitamin just like D, E and K. The active form present only in the animal tissue, whereas the provitamin form, that is in the form of beta carotene, it may be present in the plant tissues also. So there are mainly two types of compounds which have the vitamin A activity, that is retinoids and carotenoids. Now if you look into the retinoids, they are polyisoprenoids compound. This is the polyisoprenoid structure. You all know, all are very familiar with this type of chain in the cholesterol, that is it having alternate double bond. It is all trans variety, and this polyisoprenoid compound structure is connected with the ring, which is known as beta ionon ring or cyclohexanil ring. This beta ionon ring having one double bond in the beta position. Okay, so beta ionon ring followed by the polyisoprenoid structure. It may be all trans, or it may be cis, 11 cis or 9 cis, any isoform can be present. And in beta carotene, there are two beta ionon ring or cyclohexanil ring connected via a long polyisoprenoid chain. Now, what are retinoids? The retinoids are the compounds which have the vitamin A activity that are chemically related to retinol. So any compound, whatever it may be, that is natural or synthetic, which have the vitamin A activity and chemically related to retinols, are called retinoids. Now this vitamin A activity can be present as vitamin A can be present as retinol, that means vitamin A alcohol, aldehyde, that is retinal, and retinoic acid, that is vitamin A acids. This retinol and retinal, that is aldehyde and alcohol, they are interconvertible. The aldehyde can be converted to retinol through the reductase with the help of NADH plus H plus as cofactor, and vice versa. Okay, so this is reversible, but when retinal is oxidized to retinoic acid, this is unidirectional. So once retinoic acid is produced, it cannot be reverted back to aldehyde or alcohol. Now we have seen that there are long side chain, alternate, having alternate double bond. So various isoform can be present. We have already seen that all transform, that is called the A1, is most common. All trans variety called vitamin A1 is most common, and biologically important one is 11 cis retinal. Okay, the vitamin A2, A1 is present, so there must be one A2. So this A2 can be found in the fish oil. It has a peculiarity, that is a ringed structure, that is the beta ionon ring or cyclohexanil ring has an extra double bond. So two double bond present in the cyclohexanil ring in vitamin A2. Now what are carotenoids? There are plenty of carotenoids. Approximately 50 of these can be metabolized to vitamin A. And beta carotene, among those carotenoids, beta carotene is most potent and most prevalent, which can be converted to vitamin A. So it has got the provitamin A activity. This beta carotene can be present, or we can take this in the form of food supply, and it can be stored in the liver and fat. So in well-fed person, vitamin A deficiency is very unusual, because if we take adequate nutrition, the provitamin A in the form of beta carotene can be stored in the liver, which can be converted back to vitamin A and supply our necessary vitamin A. The most important provitamin A of carotenoids are alpha, beta, gamma carotenes and cryptoxanthin. Now let us have a look concisely in the vitamin A chemistry. That is, these are retinol, retinaldehyde, and retinoic acids. It may be all trans. These are all trans variety: retinol, retinaldehyde, retinoic acid, and this is 9-cis. 9-cis, and it may be 11-cis, which is very biologically active. But in case of beta carotene, 2-cyclohexanyl ring connected through a long isoprenoid alternate double bond side chain, and it can be cleaved here. The star is denoted the cleaving point. So from this picture, we have a false idea that a single beta carotene can yield 2 retinol or retinal or vitamin A. But in practice, it will not happen. We have seen that 6 microgram of beta carotene is equivalent to 1 microgram of preformed retinol. So the total amount of vitamin A in foods is expressed as microgram of retinol equivalents, because beta carotene or provitamins, carotenoids also have the vitamin A activity, and they are expressed in equivalent to retinol. So the unit of vitamin A is referred as expressed at microgram of retinol equivalents. So the beta carotene in practice doesn't produce 2 separate vitamin A in the form of retinol or retinol. It gives rise to 6 microgram of beta carotene is equivalent to 1 microgram of preformed retinol. Now comes to the sources. We have already known that the animals animals are the excellent source for vitamin A. That is, egg, fish, liver, etc. are excellent food source. But the provitamin source can be provided through the vegetables. Which type of vegetables? Colored vegetable, dark green, deeply colored. So color is not only good for our eyes, our mind, but also for our health. So colorful color is very important, isn't it? So color is good for our health too. See here, the carrots, tomatoes, spinach, cherry. So these deeply colored, dark green, deeply colored fruits and vegetables are excellent source for provitamin A. Moderate type of cooking, not excessive fry and excessive cooking, moderate cooking helps in enhancing the release of carotenoids. Okay, so it can be easily uptake by the gut. This carotenoid absorption also aided by some amount of fat in the meal. So fat is not that bad. Fat is actually essential. Actually, everything is the adequate amount, in the small amount everything is necessary. Okay, so fat is very important for absorption and transport of various important nutrients, isn't it? So colorful vegetables aided by some fat in the meal, moderate cooking, which provide the provitamins A in our system. Okay, now the absorption. How vitamin A absorbed? The beta carotene from the plant sources, they yield retinaldehyde with the help of carotene deoxygenase, which is present in the intestinal mucosa. Whereas the dietary vitamin A from animal sources, they are available in the form of retinyl ester. So both become the aldehyde. Okay, then in the intestinal mucosa, the aldehyde is reduced to alcohol, that is retinol, with the help of reductase, which required NADH or NADPH as cofactor. We have already known that. So the intestine is the major site for absorption, and for proper absorption we need bile and digestive enzymes, so that the vitamin A in the form of retinol can be integrated into the mycelium. We have already known that fat is essential for absorption, isn't it? Now in the intestinal mucosa, these retinol again deesterified with fatty acids and incorporated into the chylomicron, and through which it transported to the liver, and there it stored as retinol permeated. So first it available at aldehyde, then aldehyde is converted back to retinol via reductase. It then integrated into the mycelium with the help of bile acids, digestive enzyme, etc. And then in the intestinal mucosal cell, it is again re-esterified with fatty acid to incorporate it into the chylomicron. Then through the chylomicron, it transported to the liver, and there it's stored as retinol pumitate. Approximately 90% of the retinoids can be absorbed. Now the carotenoids. Carotenoids, first they absorb. The absorption rate is much lower. Approximately 80% of the carotenoids are absorbed. And among this 80% of the carotenoids, 90% can be converted to the retinaldehyde with the help of enzyme carotene deoxygenase, which is present in the intestinal mucosa. So 80% of the carotenoids from the foods can be absorbed, and among this 90% of the carotenoids can be converted to retinaldehyde, because the carotene deoxygenase enzyme is not 100% active for the carotenoids. Now, after absorption, it passes along with the fat through the lymphatic system into the bloodstream. Then, so these carotenoids and retinoids, they are absorbed, and this absorption is much dependent on the intestinal mucosa and the liver and the fat content of the food. So, poor absorption occurs in very commonly, we can assume that poor absorption occurs in diarrhea, jaundice, biliary tract obstruction, steatorrhea, abdominal disorders. So these are the factors which are related with the intestinal disease or liver disease or disease due to fat metabolism. These can result in poor absorption of vitamin A, whereas the absorption increase if taken with small amount of fat, because the vitamin A absorbs with the help of fat in the form of mycelium, in the form of chylomicron, etc. The unabsorbed vitamin A, because we have already seen that 80% of the carotenoids are absorbed, 90% of the retinoids are absorbed. So rest of the amount, this rest of the unabsorbed vitamin A excreted within 1 to 2 days through the feces. Now after absorption, they are transported. How? We have already discussed a little bit of it, that is through the chylomicron from the intestinal cell. With the help of chylomicron, it goes to liver. So via chylomicron from intestinal cell to the liver. Then in the liver, they binds with the retinol binding protein or RBP, and they goes to the target tissue. One molecule of RBP can binds only one molecule of retinol. So from the intestine through the help of chylomicron to liver, in the liver with the help of RBP, that is retinol binding protein, it goes to target tissues. And this RBP protein complex interacts with the second protein called transthyretin, and form a trimolecular complex. That means the retinol binding protein and transthyretin. So trimolecular complex. What is the function of this trimolecular complex? Actually, it has got three major functions. That is, this trimolecular complex protect the body against the toxicity of retinol. That means excess free retinol cannot be produced or cannot be roam through the transport through the bloodstream or lymphatic system. So protect the body against toxicity of the retinol. It prevent vitamin A from being filtered by the kidney glomerulus. So if it is trimolecular complex, it's large complex, so it cannot be easily filtered through the glomerulus. So vitamin A will not lost through the urine. And it allow retinol to be taken up by the specific cell surface receptor, because this cell surface receptor recognize the retinol binding protein. And these type of receptors are present in the various type of tissues, most common being or most potent being in the retina, skin, gonads and other tissue. So First, through the chylomicron from the intestinal cell to liver. In the liver, they binds with the retinol binding protein, and then this retinol binding protein, retinol complex binds with the transthyretin, and these trimolecular complex then goes to the specific cell surface, specific target tissue, where they can be taken up by the specific cell surface receptor that recognize retinol binding protein. So this is the mode of transportation of vitamin A. Now storage. I have already known that liver store the 90% of the vitamin A, and it is stored as retinol palmitate. Now, the under normal condition, this store, liver storage is sufficient for 6 to 9 months. So, a well-fit person has sufficient vitamin A reserve to meet his need for 6 to 9 months. Okay. So after this, it will excreted. So unabsorbed vitamin A excreted through the feces. But after this whole process, absorption, transport, and storage, it excrete through the urine. Okay, remember that it is excreted through the urine. So, but this excretion is not as readily as other substance, because it first, this trimolecular complex prevents the early or readily excretion. Okay. So when the excretion is hampered in case of any glomerular disease, any kidney disease, and aging, which also decrease the renal capacity, then this excretion can be hampered and toxicity of the vitamin A can occur due to impaired excretion. Okay. Now the functions of vitamin A. We all know that vitamin A has its enormous role in vision, all types of vision, that means night vision, day vision, as well as color vision. Other than this, it maintains the epithelial integrity, and that's why it fights against infection. And it also do so by boosting the immune response. It has also role in hematopoiesis, in the skeletal growth and the fertility, both in case of male and female, and for embryogenesis. Other than this, vitamin A is a potent antioxidant, and by its antioxidant property, it combats the free radicals, and thus it prevents cancer, heart disease, reduce skin conditions like acne, and it strengthens the immune system as a whole. Now let us discuss the role of vitamin A in vision. The retinaldehyde function as the prosthetic group of the protein opsin, which is a light sensitive protein, and this retinaldehyde and opsin form the rhodopsin. In the rhodopsin in the rods and iodopsin in the cones. We all know what is prosthetic group. So retinaldehyde acts as prosthetic groups and combined with the protein opsin to form rhodopsin or iodopsin. Now the world's visual cycle. World War, a famous scientist who was awarded Nobel Prize in 1967 for identifying the role of vitamin A in vision. The rhodopsin, which is a protein made up of the protein opsin and the prosthetic group 11 cis retinal, present in the photoreceptor cell of the retina. So it has got its pivotal role in the vision. How? Whenever light falls on the retina, even a single photon of the light can excite the rod cell. How? The photon of the light, whenever fall on the photoreceptor cell, the rhodopsin, which is made up of opsin and 11 cis retinal, see here, 11 cis retinal blocking the site of opsin like this conformation, isn't it? Now whenever light falls, then 11 cis retinal is isomerized to have a conformational change to form the all trans retinal. The all trans retinal release this space, so freeing up the opsin protein. So by this mechanism, by this conformational change, the single photon can excite the rod cell, and this change occurs through some intermediates, and this 11 trans retinal again can convert it to cis retinal to form the rhodopsin, and this cycle is called the world's visual cycle. Let's have a look on the world visual cycle in detail. Now here is the cycle. Here is the rhodopsin. Now light falls on the rhodopsin. We all know rhodopsin made of opsin and 11 cis retinal. Now photon of the light cause the conformational change of 11 cis retinal, and it's converted to rhodopsin is converted to bathrhodopsin, lumirhodopsin, metarhodopsin 1, metarhodopsin 2, and then ultimately all trans retinal by releasing the opsin. We have seen in the previous slide that the site on the opsin protein is released because of the formation of all trans retinal. This opsin is free to combine with the 11 cis retinal to form the rhodopsin again. Now this all trans retinal is converted to all trans retinol via reductase, aldehyde reductase. This all trans retinal again isomerized to 11 cis retinol, and this 11 cis retinol again oxidized to 11 cis retinal, which combined with the opsin protein, which was released after the conformation and change, and this combination of 11 cis retinal and opsin again produced the rhodopsin protein. So this cycle, that is the rhodopsin after formation getting excited by the photon of the light, it undergoes some conformational change. All these change intermediate steps are very, very unstable, just stable for few picoseconds to microseconds. So bathrhodopsin, lumirhodopsin, metarhodopsin 1, metarhodopsin 2, then ultimately it releases opsin and converted to all trans retinal retinal, and all trans retinal again reduced to all trans retinol, then isomerized to 11 cis retinol, then again oxidized to 11 cis retinal, which combined with the opsin to form the rhodopsin, and this cycle is called the world's visual cycle. Now the regeneration of the 11 cis retinal. So after production of the all trans retinal and opsin, this all trans retinal can enter the retinal epithelium through the bloodstream, and there it can be isomerized to 11 cis retinal, which then again goes to the retinal cell, where it combined with the opsin to form the rhodopsin. And then it shutting down the response. That is, the 11's combination of 11 cis retinal with the opsin is very much essential or critical for shutting off the pigment's catalytic activity. Alternatively, what can happen that this transretinal generated transretinal can enter into the liver through the bloodstream. And there in liver, there is no direct isomerization of transretinal to cis retinal. Rather, it follows the following path, that is, transretinal is converted to or reduced to retinol through ADH, that is alcohol dehydrogenase or aldehyde dehydrogenase. Then this transretinol is isomerized to cis retinol, and this cis retinol again oxidized to cis retinal, which through the bloodstream ultimately entered the retinal epithelium and combined with the opsin to shutting down the response or catalytic activity by formation of the rhodopsin or visual pigment again. So in this process in the liver, we need ADH, which is dependent on NAD or NADH as cofactor, and also zinc as cofactor, or ADH contains zinc. So zinc is very important for retinol metabolism, and in zinc deficiency, the visual problem occur in zinc deficiency also. So this regeneration of rhodopsin complete the world's visual cycle. Next come to the generation of nerve impulse. This
visual pigments are G protein coupled receptors. So after excitation, there is must be a pathway. So these visual pigments are G protein coupled receptor. And what is the visual pigment here? Transducin is the visual pigment here. So 11-cis retinal locks the receptor protein in inactive form, and the isomerization and photoexcitation leads to activation of the G protein, which is transducin. This transducin G protein produced in the retina, it then activate the phosphodiesterase enzyme. Inactive phosphodiesterase is converted to active phosphodiesterase. This active phosphodiesterase then helps in closing of the sodium channel or cation specific channel by converting the cyclic GMP to the 5' GMP. So there is a dictum that we see by inhibition. We see by inhibition. Inhibiting the sodium channel, we can see. So sodium channel or cation specific channel rather, we can see. So this transducin, which is first remain in the GDP bound state, when there is visual response or light falls in the retina, there is production of metarhodopsin. We have already seen that this metarhodopsin catalyze the formation of transducin GTP, and we get extra phosphorus from the conversion of GTP to GDP. And then this activated transducin GTP active the phosphodiesterase enzyme, and this phosphodiesterase enzyme then close the cation specific channel, and by converting cyclic GMP to 5' GMP. But how it is terminated? The nerve impulse or signal generated can be terminated by the phosphorylation of serine residue of activated rhodopsin. There is a particular serine residue which is phosphorylated by the rhodopsin kinase, a specific enzyme called rhodopsin kinase, and this phosphorylation then activate the inhibitory protein beta arrestin, which binds with the rhodopsin to inactivate it. So after excitation also inhibition is very much necessary, because otherwise our eye gets damaged. If we always exposed to the photoreceptor, always sensitive to the photoreceptor, photosensitivity occurs. So there must be shutting down of the response, and this is terminated by the beta arrestin by phosphorylation of the specific serine residue through rhodopsin kinase, and this rhodopsin kinase then activate the beta arrestin that binds with the rhodopsin to inactivate the rhodopsin protein. So shutting down of the visual response occur. Now dark adaptation. What is dark adaptation? We have seen that even a single photon can excite the rhodopsin and split it into opsin and all-trans retinal. 11-cis retinal is converted to all-trans retinal. So if a person is exposed to bright light, then its store of rhodopsin may be depleted, and then if he suddenly shift from bright light to dimly lit area, there must be difficulty in vision. There few time, a few minutes is necessary for resynthesis of the rhodopsin so that the vision can be improved. And this time, that is the time needed to synthesize or resynthesize rhodopsin, if a person suddenly shifts from bright light to dimly lit area, this time lag is called the dark adaptation time. And in vitamin A deficiency, as there is deficiency of rhodopsin, so it is readily depleted. So in the vitamin A deficiency, this dark adaptation time is increased. So person have difficulty to adapt or improve his or her vision in the dark or dimly lit area. Now there are two types of photosensitive cell. One is rod and one is cone. You all know that. So rods are for dim light vision, perception in dim light. We have already gone through all this, that is the rod main cell is rhodopsin composed of 11-cis retinal and opsin, and in the deficiency of 11-cis retinal or opsin protein, it increased the dark adaptation time and caused the night blindness. Dark adaptation, if dark adaptation time increased, it will cause night blindness. We cannot visualize properly in the dim light or night. So it is called cause the night blindness. In human, one eye contains about 120 millions of rods, and each rod contains again 120 millions of rhodopsin. So each, there are 120 millions of rods, and each rod contains 120 millions molecule of rhodopsin. In case of animals which are mainly active in night time, like cats, mice, owls, you have seen that their eyes brightened up or like green fluoresce in the night. These animals which have which contain the sharp night vision, they must have the higher number of this rod cell in their retina. Now cones, these cones are for color vision as well as for vision in the bright light. So cones are responsible for color vision and bright light. Cones contains photosensitive protein conopsin, and there are mainly you all know that the RGB, red, green, blue, these, the permutation combination of these three primary color, red, green and blue, can produce millions and millions of color, isn't it? So in our cone cell, there are three types of mainly cones present for the proper sense of the these three particular primary colors: the synopsin for perception the blue color, iodopsin for perception of green color, and porphyropsin for perception of red color. So synopsin for blue, iodopsin for green, and porphyropsin for red color. In cone, there are also 11-cis retinal molecule in the chromophore. So 11-cis retinal is present in rhodopsin as well as in the conopsin protein. So it is important for color vision also. So our one eye contains 6 millions of cone cell, and if the number reduced, then there may be difficulty in sensing the color, which result in color blindness. Red blue deficiency or red green deficiency is very much common, and that leads to color blindness. Color blindness normally refer to red green alteration. So deficiency or decreasing of number of cone cell result in color blindness. These colors have profound influence in life. You all may sometimes experience this thing. The color have profound influence in life. Oh, one thing I must say that the animals which feed themselves with insects, they have much more cone cell or much more color sensitive cell in their eye. Like chicken, like birds, they actually find the insects from the grass, from the flower, so they sense the color more vividly than us, and they need more cone cell for this purpose. Now the color is so much important that 1/3 of our gray matter and about 70% of the information input in our brain is related to the vision. So visual response is very much important for our day-to-day life. Okay, we always simulate the color with some particular situation, like optimist see the world through the rose colored eye. When we sad, we say in the blue mood, and this blue light also, blue color also make us peaceful, calm, content, but it increase the muscle tone. Whereas saffron color, it also relax the agitated person and also relax the muscle tone. Green color, if mice living in the red light, they become very active, but while in the green light, they are least active. green color soothe our eyes, isn't it? The white color has the profound effect on tranquilizing effect. Saffron also has the tranquilizing effect. So colors are very much important for generating or unlocking our automatic impulses. Now, by using these properties of color, nowadays it is applied in criminology, psychiatry, interior decoration, chromotherapy. Color gives the give a form of therapy, yoga, etc. Okay, so any prayer hall generally colored in white or light colors, mainly white color, not that bright color which excite our nerve. To soothe our nerve, we prefer calm and quiet white color, isn't it? So color is very important for our life. Now, after completion of this vision, we next go to the next effect or next function of vitamin A. Now let's discuss about the role of vitamin A in regulation of gene expression and tissue differentiation, which is one of the major role of vitamin A. So there are two families of receptor for vitamin A. One is retinoic acid receptor and one is retinoid X receptor. This RAR binds to all trans retinoic acid as well as 11 cis retinoic acid, whereas RXR binds only 11 cis retinoic acids. This retinoic acid acts like steroid hormone. You have familiar with the pathway of steroid hormone response. This retinoic acid retinoic acid is a ligand for certain nuclear receptor. So it binds with the nuclear receptors, then goes to the DNA where it binds with the specific response elements in the DNA for the and regulates the expression of specific genes. We'll discuss the pathway in the next slide. Now, by this, that is the after binding with the receptor, it in nuclear receptor, that is RAR or RXR, retinoic acids goes to the DNA and binds with its particular response element and alter the or regulate the expression of specific gene. By this way, several genes which are involved in the earlier embryogenesis process, including the differentiation of the three germ cell layers and organogenesis, these genes can be regulated. So vitamin A is very much important for embryogenesis and the tissue differentiation. There are more than hundreds of genes which are regulated by retinoic acid through this procedure, okay, mainly through RAR. RXR, that is retinoic X receptor, which is generally binds to the 11 cis retinoic acid, they also form dimer with the vitamin D. So it due to this relation of vitamin A with the D, in the impairment of vitamin D, that is the deficiency of vitamin D, also impair the biochemical effect of vitamin A. So that's why vitamin A and vitamin D are interrelated or interconnected. Next, let us see the pathway of gene transcription. We have already discussed the 11 cis retinoic acid or all trans retinoic acid. They binds with all trans retinoic acid binds with the RAR. RAR can also bind the cis retinoic acid, and RXR is specific for 9 cis retinoic acid. So these retinoic acids, they enter into the nucleus through the retinoic acid binding protein. Through retinoic acid binding proteins, then they binds with their specific receptor in the nucleus, and this RAR binds with the trans and RXR binds with the cis retinoic acid, they forms a heterodimer, and this heterodimer then goes to the DNA and binds with the specific response element, that is RAR. It is called retinoic acid response element. Retinoic acid response elements in the specific portion of the DNA, which is responsible for the expression of specific gene. Now, gene transcription is regulated by this mechanism other than embryogenesis and tissue differentiation. By this mechanism, they increase the gene expression in the gonads and maintain the reproductive tissues. That's why we have said in the function of vitamin A, it is very important for the reproductive function of fertility of both male and female, and it also regulates the differentiation of the epithelial cells. So it is important for maintaining the integrity of the epithelial cell. Now, role in epithelial integrity. Vitamin A, it has got central role in also in development and differentiation of white blood cells such as lymphocytes. And we all know white blood cell is very important for immune response. So vitamin A is also related with the immune response. Skin and mucous membrane, these are the first line of defense against the infection, acts as barrier, and the integrity of skin and mucous membrane is also maintained by vitamin A. And where it is deficiency of vitamin A, the skin or mucous membrane becomes keratinized, and keratinization of the mucous membrane adds up the risk of infection, because the primary defense against the infection is damaged due to lack of vitamin A. So vitamin A is also important for immune response and defense mechanism by maintaining the epithelial integrity. Other than this, the retinol binding proteins acts as negative acute phase protein, and whether there is results in decreased circulatory concentration of vitamin, it further deteriorates the immune response. It has got its role in growth also. The vitamin A related with the growth of bone, growth of brain, that is development of the brain, and also the general body growth. So it is important for general body growth, growth of bone, and also the development of brain. Now, the role in reproduction. We have already known that retinoic acids is important for expressing the certain or regulate the certain genes related with the normal reproduction. It has been found in the mice that in case of vitamin A deficiency in the female rat, there is miscarriage occur in the female rats, while atrophy of the germinal epithelium and sterility can be occur in male rats. So vitamin A is important for reproductive health. Miscarriage in female and atrophy of germinal epithelium and sterility in male rats can be observed in experimental animal. Vitamin A also has got its antioxidant property, and due to this antioxidant property, it has got its role in cancer prevention as well as cardiovascular diseases. It has been seen that the fresh vegetables and that contains the carotenoids, they has the antioxidant property, and they reduce the chances of epithelial cancers, like risk of lung cancer, oral cancer, or prostate cancer can be reduced. And the greater than 5 servings of fruits and vegetables which are rich in carotenoids, due to its antioxidant property, they also can reduce or prevent the cardiovascular diseases. Other than this, main function, that is maintenance of the vision, promotion of growth, differentiation and maintenance of the epithelial tissue, gene expression and maintenance of reproduction through this gene expression, there are some other action which is related to the therapy, that means the therapeutic use of vitamin A in the form of all trans retinoic acid. So this all trans retinoic acid can be used therapeutically in case of skin disease, especially for the acne and for the psoriasis, and it can be also used in the AML or PML, that is promyelocytic leukemia, because it has got role in the differentiation of the white blood cell. We have already discussed about that. So, vitamin A is important for proper differentiation of the white blood cell, including lymphocytes. So it has got its therapeutic benefit in promyelocytic leukemia or AML also. So vitamin A is important for day-to-day activity, for proper maintenance of the health and hygiene, and as well as it can be used in the therapeutic format too. Now, the deficiency manifestation of vitamin A. As we all know, the ocular manifestation are much more common for vitamin A deficiency, because vitamin A is very much essential for vision. So obviously the ocular symptoms are heavier than the extraocular one, but the extraocular one is also common and serious one. So ocular symptoms being array of symptom as a whole called the xerophthalmia. These are night blindness, conjunctival xerosis, bitter spots, corneal xerosis, keratomalacia, and extraocular being the follicular hyperkeratosis, anorexia, and growth retardation. Now we will discuss it one by one. First, the ocular deficiency manifestation. The whole symptom, as a whole, the whole array is called the xerophthalmia. Started with night blindness, that is the person have difficulty in adapting in the dark, and dark adaptation time is increased and visual acuity diminished in dim light. So this is the normal vision in dim light for the normal person. If the person having night blindness, this is the difference. See the difference? See the difference here? Okay, so this is the difference. By the night blind person see the world in the dim light like this. Okay, then come the conjunctival xerosis. The conjunctival xerosis, here the conjunctiva becomes dry, thickened, wrinkled. Okay, dry, thickened, wrinkled, and the normal transparency of the conjunctiva is diminished. And because of this dryness, lusterness, and this wrinkled conjunctiva, the infection may be superseded. And poetically, it is described as, which is also accepted in our study book also, it is called the emerging like sand banks at the receding tide. So conjunctival xerosis is just metaphorized as emerging like sand banks at the receding tide. So conjunctiva becomes dry, thickened, wrinkled, lusterless, or transparency decreased. Then comes the bitter spots. What is bitter spots? Due to the increased thickness of the conjunctiva in the certain area, conjunctival thickness increased in certain area or certain area, and a grayish triangular plaque appears in that area, which is called the bitter spot. So due to the increased thickness of the conjunctiva in particular area, there is grayish triangular patch appears, which is firmly adherent to the conjunctiva, which is called bitter spot. Up to this, that is night blindness followed by conjunctival xerosis, and these bitter spots, these are preventable, absolutely preventable, that means reversible. Then comes the corneal xerosis. Once the cornea becomes dull, dry, non-wettable, and opaque, then the condition is very grave, because vitamin A supplementation may not or almost never revert back the normal vision. So it affects the vision, and if the corneal xerosis heal at all, it may lead to corneal ulceration or perforation. Okay, so here after conjunctiva, the cornea becomes thick, dull, transparency decreased, becomes opaque, and the condition is very grave indeed. Next comes the keratomalacia. When the xerophthalmia, that is the whole array of symptoms, any symptoms, persists for a long time, ultimately it results in softening and liquefaction of the cornea. So keratomalacia means softening and liquefaction of the cornea. See here, just like cornea is liquefied and in the gravity they accumulate here. So following the gravity they accumulate here. So cornea becomes softened and liquefied. It is a medical emergency. Whenever the keratomalacia develop, it is a medical emergency condition. Okay, so for this, bacterial infection can be supersedes on this, and there may be perforation, and after that the ulceration, perforation, and there is corneal scar, permanent damage, and which cause the blindness, and it is the one of the major cause of blindness in India. Okay, so xerophthalmia, that means dry eye. We have seen that conjunctiva become dry, cornea becomes dry, and transparency decreased, it becomes thick, wrinkled. So whole the area of manifestation of dry eye, this ocular manifestation of vitamin A deficiency as a whole is called xerophthalmia. It is leading cause of blindness in Southeast Asian population. Okay, and most commonly affected group is children aged 1 to 3 years, 1 to 3 years, and which children are in greater risk? The greater risk of the children of ignorant parents due to faulty feeding practice, that is related with the weaning and infection and the protein energy malnutrition. So the ignorance, faulty feeding practice, often the practice related with the weaning, the nutritional deficiency associated with protein energy malnutrition, and the superadded infection, which are diarrhea, measles, which are common in children. This group of children are very much prone to develop the ocular manifestation of vitamin A deficiency. In North Indian states, the xerophthalmia is somehow less common, whereas the states of South Indian state, Andhra Pradesh, Tamil Nadu, Karnataka, and also our state, West Bengal, is a badly affected state of this vitamin A associated visual problem, which may lead to blindness. Now, preventable blindness. We have already seen that the up to betot spot, it is easily preventable by giving a large dose of vitamin A. We also incorporate the large dose of vitamin A under one year age of children as the immunization protocol. Actually 40% of the blindness is preventable, because vitamin A associated blindness is most common in children, most common cause of blindness in children below 5 years of age. So after giving a large dose of vitamin A, because vitamin A can be stored in the liver, we have known that, so 40% of the blindness is preventable. We have huge burden of blindness. Actually 1/3 of the world's blind population residing in India. So it is a serious condition, and that's why the single dose of vitamin A given as prophylactic measure, it is incorporated in our immunization schedule. Now comes the extraocular manifestation. Most commonly affected organ is skin and mucous membrane. The follicular hyperkeratosis or phrenoderma. What is phrenoderma? It is result from the keratinization of the epithelium lining the follicles, and due to keratinization the skin becomes dry. Other epithelium of respiratory tract, gastrointestinal tract, genitourinary tract, it also there may be keratinizing metaplasia also. So these lining epithelium of the respiratory, GI, or genitourinary tracts have also been affected, and results in urinary calculi in the renal tissue. The epithelium may be atrophied. The alteration of the skin may cause occurrence of infection because skin is the first line of barrier. So, alteration of the skin or keratinization of the epithelium leads to generalized infection. So, in the old time, vitamin A is referred as anti-inflammatory vitamin. In the therapeutic use, that's why in the therapeutic use, isotretinoin, a synthetic variant of vitamin A, is used to reduce the adolescent origin acne or psoriasis, etc. Okay, so these are the follicular hyperkeratosis of trinoderma, which is the alteration of the epithelium in the various tissue, and hyperkeratinization of the epithelium occurs. They are prone to develop infection. This is the most common extraocular manifestation. There are other general manifestation other than the visual manifestation. These are growth retardation, decreased synthesis of the protein, especially the glycoprotein content. And due to this lower glycoprotein content and the lower synthesis of the chondroitin sulfate, skeletal growth is hampered. There may be anemia because it helps in differentiation of the leukocyte and blood count. So there may be anemia, there may be infertility. We have also already known that the huge role of vitamin A in reproductive tissue, both in male and female, so related with fertility, so leads to infertility. Reduced immunity against infection. There may be anorexia, headache, drowsiness. These are the very common general manifestations for the low grade vitamin A deficiency. So anorexia, headache, drowsiness, and peeling of the skin about the mouth and elsewhere. So these are the deficiency symptoms of vitamin A. Now, what may be the causes of vitamin A deficiency? We have come to know that vitamin A is sufficiently stored by the liver, so deficiency is very less common. So, vitamin A deficiency must be related to the decreased intake and any disease which hamper the storage or the transport or increase the excretion of the vitamin A. So, the disease affecting the liver, such as obstructive jaundice, cirrhosis of liver, cystic fibrosis, these may cause bile duct obstruction. These may cause the vitamin A deficiency. Other than this, severe malnutrition in any other form, such as fat malabsorption or the protein energy malnutrition, may cause vitamin A deficiency because fat is essential for vitamin A transport. So that the retinol binding protein is also very much necessary for adequate transport of vitamin A. So severe malnutrition may cause vitamin A deficiency. Other than this, few diseases like pancreatic insufficiency, duodenal bypass, bile duct obstruction, giardiasis, cirrhosis, these may cause the vitamin A deficiency. Now, what are the vulnerable group for vitamin A deficiency? Those who are dependent on others for the nutrition, like infancy, childhood. In that group where the need is increased, like pregnancy, lactation, where there is malnutrition due to their financial condition, like urban poor. Older adults are also very much vulnerable, and some person with some disease like alcoholism, liver disease, fat malabsorption, increased excretion due to cancer or urinary tract infection, low protein intake as a whole resulting deficient carrier, like that means retinol binding protein, these may cause the person to vulnerable of vitamin A deficiency. Now, how we could assess the vitamin A deficiency? Vitamin A deficiency can be assessed by some direct measurement and some indirect measurement. So, for dark adaptation test, it is very much essential for assessment of deficiency because preliminary manifestation of vitamin A deficiency is ocular, and that is the night blindness. First stage of vitamin A deficiency is night blindness, where we have come to know that dark adaptation time is increased. So if this time is increased, it denotes the vitamin A deficiency. Now, the retinol binding protein level assessment of serum retinol and blood level of vitamin A is very usual useful for assessing the vitamin A deficiency. Normal RBP level is in the serum is decreased in vitamin A deficiency. Serum retinol level, which is normal value, is 28 to 86 microgram per dl, that is decreased in vitamin A deficiency. And obviously, if it is vitamin A deficiency, so normal blood level of vitamin A, which is 25 to 50 milligram per dl, that is also decreased. The blood level of vitamin A can be measured by colorimetric assessment or by direct spectrophotometry. The absorption maxima for vitamin A is 325 nanometer. 325 nanometer wavelength vitamin A gives is maximum absorption maxima in spectrophotometric assessment. Now, there are some other associated factors we can measure in vitamin to assess the vitamin A deficiency, like serum zinc level, iron panel, albumin level, complete blood count and DC, or that means differential counts, and electrolyte and liver function test. Why? Serum zinc level, we have come to know that zincin is associated with the enzyme alcohol dehydrogenase or aldehyde dehydrogenase, which is important for interconversion of retinol to retinaldehyde and vice versa. And it is also essential for RBP production, that means retinol binding product protein production. So serum zinc level, zinc deficiency can manifest the or aggravate the vitamin A deficiency. Iron panel is also important because to differentiate the vitamin A deficiency from anemia, because in both case there are first line of vague symptom of low grade vitamin A deficiency is very much similar with the iron deficiency anemia. So an iron panel is very important. Albumin level to assess the general protein status, because protein energy malnutrition is a common cause of vitamin A deficiency. So albumin level is also very much useful. Vitamin A is also essential for proliferation and differentiation of the WBC. So complete blood count along with differential count is also important, and this is also important for ruling out other causes like anemia, infection, sepsis, which may increase or supersede the or add the aggravate the vitamin A deficiency symptom. Electrolyte evaluation and liver function studies also important to evaluate the overall nutritional status and the volume status. Now, what may be is the daily requirement for vitamin A? Vitamin A is in for 400 to 600 milligram per day is essential for children. For men and for pregnancy, it is more or less around 1000 milligram per day, whereas for women it is 750 milligram per day is adequate for vitamin A. One international unit of vitamin A is equal to 0.3 milligram of retinol, whereas retinol equivalent means 1 microgram of retinol, and 1 microgram of retinol means 6 microgram of beta carotene. So retinol equivalent 1 microgram of retinol is equal to 6 microgram of beta carotene. This chart also shows the age wise requirement of vitamin A both in male and female, and pregnancy and lactation. Now, what are the therapeutic uses of vitamin A? As we have all known by this time, that vitamin A related blindness is most common in our country, and West Bengal being one of the most affected portion, most affected state, and about 80% of the global blindness caused by vitamin A deficiency resides in our part of the world. So any blindness or any deficiency suspected of vitamin A deficiency should be treated urgently and vigorously. So nearly all early stages of xerophthalmia, maybe night blindness or whatever it may be, can be reversed. We have come to know, already know, that the first three steps of ocular manifestation are completely reversible. So if we administer massive doses of vitamin A in the form of retinol permeate orally on two successive days, it may reverse the vitamin A disease or ocular manifestation of vitamin A disease. So what is the dose? This is the 2 lakh international unit, 2 lakh international units of retinal permitted orally on 2 successive days can reverse the early manifestation of any form of xerophthalmia. Now, once the corneal ulcer is suspected, it is emergency condition, so should be treated aggressively immediately on diagnosis. If the age is less than 6 months, then 50,000 international unit. If 6 to 12 months of age, 1 lakh international unit, and this dose should be followed in the next day, that means successive days, and after 2 weeks also. Okay, so 50,000 dose first day, 50,000 dose second days, and 2 weeks after for less than 6 months of age, and for 6 to 12 months of age, it is 1 lakh international unit, 2 successive days, and after 2 weeks also. Okay. So that is the therapeutic doses of vitamin A for any ocular manifestation of vitamin A. And the therapeutic dose is generally 20 to 550 times higher than the recommended daily allowance. Okay. Other than this therapeutic use for ocular manifestation, that is also we have taught earlier that vitamin A can be used for medicine or therapeutic purpose in leukemia, promyelocytic leukemia, where all transretinoic acid is used as adjuvant because it has its role in differentiation of the cells, so it may cause remission in promyelocytic leukemia. Other than this, skin manifestation like psoriasis, acne, adolescent acne also can be treated by retinoic acid or isotretinoin, which is a synthetic analog of vitamin A. So these are the therapeutic uses of vitamin A. Now let us discuss briefly about hypervitaminosis A or vitamin A toxicity. So not only the deficiency is dangerous, but also excessive anything is also bad for our health. So hypervitaminosis or vitamin A toxicity, why this occur? Because we have come to know that vitamin A is stored adequately for 6 to 9 months in liver. Okay, so if one is over zealous to supplementing the vitamin A, it may result in toxicity, which is very common in children where parents are over zealous in supplementing the vitamin A. In case of Eskimos generally they feed on liver of the polar bear because this is available there, and other foods are also very food supply is constrained, so they used to feed on liver of polar bear, but then they refrain from it. Why? Because of this high vitamin content in the liver of polar bear, which results in toxicity due to vitamin A overdose. This toxicity may be acute or chronic, and most of the toxicity symptoms are related with the increased intracranial pressure due to hypervitaminosis A. The symptoms of toxicity include very vague symptoms, so it is very difficult to understand it is due to hypervitaminosis A because they are very common in various types of syndrome like anorexia, irritability, headache, drowsiness, vomiting, peeling of skin. These are very common symptoms for increased intracranial pressure, like headache, especially the headache, drowsiness, vomiting. These are the symptoms for increased intracranial tension. Other than then, anorexia, irritability, peeling of skin, that may the manifestation of vitamin A toxicity or hypervitaminosis A. So these signs may be due to increased intracranial tension, and there may be sometimes bony exostosis can be occur. What is bony exostosis? Bony exostosis means painful swelling over the long bones. Painful swelling over the long bones because vitamin A is important for the growth of the long bones, and if there is increased vitamin A, there may be painful bones or swelling over the long bones may occur. It is called bony exostosis. Enlargement of the liver can be seen in children also, and higher concentration of the retinin increase the lysosomal enzyme, which are lysosomal enzyme are mainly hydrolysis. They cause the cellular death. Hypercarotenemia can be occurred if one is persistently consume excessive amount of food which are rich in carotenoids. So एक्सेसिव कंजप्शन ऑफ फूड्स रिच इन कैरोटीनॉइड्स में रिजल्ट्स इन हाइपर कैरोटीनेमिया एंड दैट लीड्स टू येलोइश डिस्कलरेशन ऑफ द स्किन बट द स्क्लेरा रिमेन व्हाइट बिकॉज येलोइश डिस्कलरेशन ऑफ द स्क्लेरा इज टिपिकल मैनिफेस्टेशन ऑफ द जॉन्डिस सो हियर द cabbage color or yellowish or orangish discoloration of the skin may occur due to hyperkeratinemia so these are the manifestation of vitamin A toxicity so in this the whole topic we have come to know the chemistry of vitamin A its transport from the absorption to storage and from excretion and then the deficiency symptoms its management, its hypervitaminosis, that means toxicity symptom, and the therapeutic use of vitamin A. So, with this, we can finish our discussion on vitamin A and be colorful, eat colorful vegetables, but not in excess and in adequate amount. Okay, so study and have a nice day. Be safe. Thank you.